just come to you this morning. We just ask you, Lord, that that would just be the prayer of each and every one here in this place this morning, that we would just come running to your arms. Lord, just when the difficult things that we face in our life, we just ask you that you would just help remind us, even as we're just thinking about the poem, that when times get difficult, regardless whether it's a relational problem, a health problem, a financial problem, it's not because you've abandoned us, Lord, but oftentimes you use those things to draw us to you. And I just ask you, Lord, that you would just beckon to each one of us here this morning, Lord, that we would just come running into your arms, that we would just recognize that in you we have everything that we need. And even if things around us seem to be falling apart at times, Lord, we just ask you that you would just help us to see you and to realize that you will take care of us, Lord, and you will meet our needs. Not always our wants, not always the things that we think that we need, Lord, but what we truly need. So, Lord, I just ask you that you would just help us, that we would just come to you, that we would just seek the relationship with you, that we would just fall in love with you day to day. And, Lord, just recognizing that when it seems like we have nothing else, that we have you. So, Lord, I just ask that you would just fill our hearts with praise this morning, recognizing that you are the author and the finisher of our faith, that you are our joy, you are our salvation, and that we could just rest in you and just have peace in you and the relationship that we have with you. And, Lord, if there's one here this morning that just does not have that peace, hasn't experienced that today would be the day that they would just lay down what they need to let go of and just give it to you. Lord, I just ask you that you would just break the chains in our lives that are just keeping us from you, keeping us from that relationship with you, and that you would just wrap your arms around each and every one of us, and that you would draw us to you. Lord, we just thank you for all of these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Justice and praise. control consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out.
At this time, we're going to dismiss the children to get downstairs for children's church. Just greet one another here this morning. Just walk around and just make everyone here this morning feel welcome.
Is it on? Okay. I'm not going to sing a song today, but I just wanted to share something with you guys. A couple weeks ago, my family and I went to Ocean Grove in New Jersey, and it was to visit my brother, Tyler, because his band that he's in the summer from Messiah was playing there. They were spending a couple days there. And so we went out and had a great time visiting with him. And one night, my family and Tyler and a couple of his friends were all sitting near the beach, just singing some songs together. And this man came up to the side of the pavilion, the pavilion where we were sitting, and he didn't interrupt us. He waited for the song to be over. But after the song ended, he said, you know, those songs are really nice, and asked us where we were from and stuff. But then he said, have you guys gone out on the boardwalk at all and had a chance to witness to anybody, to share your faith? And we said, well, no, not really. We've just been singing songs for an hour or so. And he said, well, you know, I'd just really encourage you guys to get out there and share your faith. There's all sorts of people out there who need to hear the word of God. And just in the past hour or so, I've just been walking around and I've had the chance to share Christ with 15 or 20 people or something. And so when I first heard this, I was kind of taken aback a little bit. I thought, well, this guy's just being arrogant or something. But then he started to tell us these stories, and before long I was just mesmerized by every word he was saying. He travels a lot, and he's a Christian writer and an author, and it turned out that two of my brother's friends actually knew of him as an author. They just didn't know what he looked like, but they had read two of his books. And he was just sharing with us that in his travels at different hotels and airports and things like that he's gone to, he's had the chance to witness to all these different celebrities and just people like Kanye West and he's friends with Albert Pujols, the baseball player. And so any of you who are a baseball fan, you may have heard before. Albert Pujols is a strong Christian man, and he plays first base. So if you watch baseball, you know that when a runner gets on first base, they lead off a little bit, just to get off the bag so that they can try to steal and get to second base faster. Well, Albert Pujols has to go and stand by the base so that he can try to get the runner out. And this guy's name is Mark Cahill, by the way, the author. And he's the person who encouraged Albert Pujols to share Christ with the base runners when they're standing beside him on first base. And he has a window of 30 seconds to a minute before that runner's going to take off and run to the next base. So he has virtually no time. And Mark Cahill challenged Albert Pujols to share his faith with the runner on first base as he's standing there. And that just blew my mind, and so Albert Pujols does that regularly now. Mark told me that it's definitely a scary thing to do at first, just to approach a person at random and try to strike up a conversation about Christ. But he just made an analogy that made sense to me, that it's just like anything else you do, that it's just practice. And so I told him that I play the piano, and he said, well, yeah, so like that. At first, playing piano in front of people was probably frightening. But the more you do it, the more you practice. You become comfortable doing that. And he said that about 2 months after he talked to Albert Pujols about doing that, that Albert sent him an email and said, "Like, Mark, I'm not afraid anymore. I can just do this." And you know, and he said, you know, at first, like, I could see the guys going back in their dugout and talking to each other and pointing at me and like, "Albert's crazy. He was just telling me about Jesus on first base in the middle of a major league baseball game." So, he told us these amazing stories, and then at the end, he said, "Are you guys going out to breakfast together tomorrow morning?" And we said, "Well, we weren't really planning on it, but you know, we can." I thought he was going to ask us if we wanted to go to breakfast with him at first, but wishful thinking maybe. but he said, "Okay, well, here's what I want you to do. I want you guys," and there were about a dozen of us, including my family and Tyler's friends. There were about a dozen of us there. He said, "I want you to all go out and eat breakfast at a restaurant tomorrow morning. He opened up his wallet. He said, "Here is $80. He gave us $80 and said, "I want you to go get breakfast, and whatever you don't use of this money, I want you to give your waitress the rest as a tip. I want you to give her a nice tip, just because that's a good testimony as Christians. And I want you to share Christ with your waitress." And so it's like, wow, this just got real now. Like, this is a specific situation. The next morning we went out and gave the waitress I think $15 that was left over for the tip, and Tyler's the one who talked to her a little bit. But Mark had given us a couple books, and one was geared towards people who are not saved yet, and one is geared towards believers. And so the waitress told us she was from Lithuania, so she had a cool accent. It was funny, but she told us that the owners of the restaurant were a pastor and his wife. And so Tyler told her that the only reason we had come there to get breakfast that morning was because of what had happened the night before. And he shared the story with her and told her the only reason we were there, it wasn't just for breakfast, but because Jesus loves her so much, and that we wanted to share that with her. And and she didn't accept Christ right on the spot, but she was just like overwhelmed. You could see she was tearing up and just kind of emotional. And Tyler gave her the book that was geared towards the non-believer, and asked if he would give the book for the believer to the owners of the restaurant, the pastor and his wife. And that book, this is also just a cool concept. It's called the One Thing You Can't Do in Heaven. And Mark just shared with me that's because there's really only one thing that you cannot do in heaven, besides sin, I guess. But the one thing that you can't do in heaven is share Christ with lost people, because there aren't any lost people in heaven. And he really just, at least in me, and I know in my friends and my family, planted an urgency for sharing Christ with people in my heart. And it's definitely still kind of frightening, but it's just something I've really felt convicted of since then, and I just really want to pray about for myself, and I just wanted to share that with all of you. And we don't have to wait until we've built up a long lasting relationship with people to share Jesus with them, because some people, you know, you never know what could happen. Somebody could die before you have a chance if you wait too long. So I just encourage you all to pray about that. And if you want to talk to me after the service, he has a website, and he will actually send you some free a book, and I think some materials to help you get started with that. And I know he's sending my family a package to help us sort of get started with that whole concept. But I just really encourage you guys, just as you go out there, don't, you know, it doesn't matter if we look foolish to other people, just share Christ with everyone that you can, because there are people dying and going to hell, lost. So we just have a responsibility to share that love. So I just encourage you guys to do that. So
I always just so much appreciate the stories of life lived, Christian life lived in our streets and in our communities, and just a blessing to hear when people are acting missional, when they're taking the mission to their community, and what a blessing it is to hear. We have been going through Romans, and we've made it to chapter 6, and there's a major change in topic in chapter 6 of Romans, where we have been studying and learning about justification, really, beginning in chapter 1 and through the first three chapters anyway. We learned of the sinful nature that we all possess. We've learned that every person, whoever walks this earth, needs Christ, that Christ is the only way that we can be right with God, that God's expectation is righteousness, it's perfection, really, and none of us are that. And that puts us all in the position of needing some means of achieving righteousness, because that's what's required. And God provided that through Christ. Christ is our righteousness. And when we believe, we've received the righteousness of Christ, so we are justified. We are made right. We can stand before God because of that. And now there's this kind of a dramatic shift. And I don't want to say it's dramatic in that it has no relation to what he's talked about, because it does systematically, logically flow right into the next point. And that is on the idea of sanctification. And sanctification is one of those church words, one of those things that we say, we throw around a lot, even to the point where we don't even maybe think about what it really means. But it's a very important and practical truth in Christian living, sanctification. It comes from a Greek word, hagiazo, which means to purify or to set apart. And you think about purification literally means to set apart. You're removing the impurities from the pure substance, whatever it might be. And so it's to set apart, to purify. And when used in Christianity, we're talking about the purification of our life, the removal of the impurities, so that we can be the pure believer that God intends us to be. We need to understand this, though. It does not happen at once. It is never complete while we walk this earth. It is a process. It is something that the moment that we believe, we begin the process of sanctification. And literally, it is becoming more and more like Jesus. The impurities are being removed. They're being taken away. They're being discarded as we become more and more like Christ. And justification happens the moment that we are saved, while sanctification happens moment by moment. Justification happens the moment that you're saved. Sanctification happens moment by moment. It's a process. It goes on. As justification begins the process, sanctification builds on that and continues. And it's a very practical term, because what it means is we're becoming more like Christ. And when we have received Christ, when we begin our walk as a Christian, ultimately that's our goal here as Christians, as people who live on this earth. I want to be more like Jesus. And sanctification is the process where we are becoming more like Jesus. And it's really the kind of thing that maybe we're more, our ears kind of lean forward, and we kind of want to know, because we've just gone through some really theoretical kind of difficult concepts when it comes to justification, because it's something that is invisible to us. It's something that's occurring on the inside, where sanctification is more kind of external, happening on the outside, because we are changing the way we act. We are changing the way we behave. And we are beginning to look more and more from the outside. People looking at us, we are looking more and more like Christ. And that's the goal of sanctification, where justification is how we are saved now. Sanctification, how do we live now that we are saved? And so one ties in with the other. And it's for us to fully understand the idea of sanctification, we need to understand the idea of justification. And that is why Paul spent five chapters making certain that we understood why it is that we're justified, how it is that we're made right. And now, knowing that and understanding that, we can begin to be sanctified, or we can begin to understand the idea of sanctification. So we're going to begin in Romans chapter 6 at verse 1. Before we read this morning, let's pray together. Lord, we do thank you for the chance to be together again, and pray, God, that you use this time in us in a profitable way. I would pray, God, that as we begin this idea of studying sanctification, understanding sanctification, being made more like Jesus, that God, you would lay these truths on our heart that would begin that process in us, that would enhance, speed up that process in us. Help us, Lord, to be changed as a result of the time that we spend in your word today. We thank you, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Romans chapter 6, verse 1 says this: "What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer?" Paul begins here with a rhetorical question. A rhetorical question is a question that really isn't asked to get an answer. It's asked to make a statement. He's not actually considering the possibility. Is it possible that since grace is more evident, more clearly seen when I sin, then it would be better if I sinned? He's asking that question to reveal to us just really the preposterous nature of that. That it would be better if I continued to sin, because then everyone can really see God's grace, and I can experience more of God's grace. So that means it would be a good thing if I sin more. And I don't believe he's actually asking that question because someone has asked it to him. I think he's revealing the incongruous nature of sin and salvation. The fact that we are saved, we are justified, we're made right, we're set apart, and now our life should change. Sin should not be the prominent picture, the prominent item in our life as it was before. And he's pointing that out with this question. And so, usually when someone asks a rhetorical question, they're not actually seeking an answer. What they're doing is making a point. And that is what he's doing here. He's making a point about the fact that Christians, as we're saved, we've been justified, we've been made right before God, we should not continue in sin. And he's going to go through this change that has occurred. Because that's the reality is there is a change that has occurred. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that you are a new creature. That something dramatic has changed in your life, in your salvation, that should result in a different kind of living. And he says it that we are dead to sin. Now that's a little bit difficult for us to understand. We don't use that kind of terminology, but it would be somewhat like this. Somebody upsets you and say, "You know what? You're dead to me." And what you're saying is, "I have no relation with you anymore as a result of this." And really, that's what he's saying. You're dead to sin. That connection, that relation that was there before, it's not there anymore. And if we were to summarize what he's saying here, he's talking about the relationship between the slave and the master. And what he's saying is that you're dead to sin, is that you are no longer under the authority of that slave master. That slave master, that was sin, that relationship has been killed. It's done. It's no longer your master. You don't have to do that any longer. And so the Christian is no longer under the old slave master's sin, but we now serve the new master, and that's Jesus. And so he uses, and throughout Scripture, he uses this image of this picture of being a slave to sin. We are saved, and so that slave, that bond is broken, and now we are slave to Christ. And that is the picture of what, that he's giving us here in the beginning of the sanctification process. When you were lost, when you were apart from Christ, you were obligated to sin. Sin was all that you could do. And now sin no longer has the say over you. You now have a choice. Then verse 3 and 4, he says this, "Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have a new life." Now the baptism that's spoken of here, I don't believe that he's speaking literally of a water baptism. Even though, and we're going to talk about that just in a moment, the relation to what he's saying. But I don't think he said, what he's saying is that what has happened to you, this change is a result of your immersion in water, that baptism. He's talking about the baptism that means we have been immersed in Christ. We are now identified with Christ. And so he says that what it means is that just as Christ died, we are dead to sin. He was buried. We are buried with Christ. We are raised up in new life in Christ. And so our baptism that we experience now, which is important, is a demonstration of our baptism in Christ. Your water baptism didn't bring about your new life. Your salvation, your justification in Christ brought out your new life. Your justification in that you are dead to sin and you have been raised up to new life in Christ. So when we walk you out in the water, we are demonstrating that. We are giving the world a picture of that. And so when you are walked into the water, you have already been your sin. You are dead to your sin. But what we're saying is you have died to sin and you have been raised to new life in Christ. That baptism is a picture of that. It's a demonstration of that. It is your testimony, your statement to the world that I am dead to sin and I am raised to new life in Christ. And so, don't misunderstand me to think somehow, well, that means baptism is not important. It's very important. But what it is your public declaration, demonstration of this fact that occurred the moment that you were saved. You are dead to sin, and you have been brought up in new life in Christ. And I say this, if you've never been baptized, the Bible makes it very clear, you need to be baptized. It should be the first act of obedience in a new Christian. We should be baptized. And if you've never been baptized, talk to me, because we're going to baptize you. I'd love to do that. In fact, we're going to be having a baptism real soon. I've had some of the young people who have made decisions in recent years, and we're going to baptize them. If you've never been baptized, we would love to include you in that too. But water baptism is a public demonstration of the fact that we have died to sin, we are buried with Christ, and we are raised to new life in Christ. And now we are identified with Him. And Romans chapter 6, in these first few verses, is a really good picture of that. It's a real good picture of the reality of our baptism in Christ and the need to experience a water baptism here in this world. So continue in verse 5 through verse 10, he says this, "For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God." Now, there's an important word that appears multiple times in that passage, and the word is "know." He says, we know this. We know this to be true. And so, sanctification begins with knowledge. It begins by knowing and understanding these truths that we're looking at. Sanctification begins with the knowledge of who we are in Christ. We can't begin to be sanctified if we do not even know, we do not even understand that we are no longer under the slave master that was sin. If you don't know that, you can't possibly be sanctified. You can't grow in Christ. You can't become more like Jesus if you do not know what has been done. That Jesus' death has killed the dominance of sin over your life, if you know Him as Savior. And so sanctification begins with that knowledge. You know, when Abraham Lincoln wrote the Emancipation Proclamation, which most of you probably know was the document, the statement that freed the slaves, you know that there were slaves still living on the plantations, still serving masters. And Abraham Lincoln, I suppose, in Washington, D.C., wrote this document. And that document said that slaves were free. They had no obligation to their master. They were free to live on their own. Now, if you were a slave living in the Deep South and you didn't have Fox News or CNN, you would have not known that. You had not even known that was true. Now, how would they be experiencing the freedom that came? Absolutely not. For all they knew, they were still slaves. And they would continue to live as slaves until they heard the news that they had been freed. And the same thing is true for Christians. If we don't know, if we don't even have the knowledge to understand that you are no longer obligated to sin, then you are going to live continually in that slave relationship with sin. And so in the same way that as the news of the Emancipation Proclamation trickled out, as it reached the deepest parts of the South, all of a sudden there was this new reality. I'm no longer a slave. I'm no longer obligated to my master. And that's the same thing with us as Christians. As we understand that, we can begin to experience freedom. Freedom apart from sin. And the freedom to live as God intended us to live. So once you know the reality, what do you do next? I mean, now that I know that, maybe you walked in here today and said, I didn't know that. I had no idea that bond has been broken, that I was no longer obligated, that I had a choice in this. What do you do next? Well, look at verse 11. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Count yourself. It says reckon. What it's saying is believe it to be true. Really, what it's saying is that I agree with what God has said about this issue. It's not enough just to know this. It's not enough just to know that God has said, I'm no longer under the bondage of sin. I have been freed from that. We have to believe that to be true. For many Christians, we know, we have an intellectual understanding, but we really don't believe it. And so we don't live that way. You know, in the South, when the Emancipation Proclamation was declared, there were slaves who, they heard about it, and the reality of that was frightening to them. In fact, they didn't know what to do next. This was all they knew. This is all I've ever lived. I grew up here. I don't know anything else. And you know what they did? They stayed right where they were. They would go to the house, to the slave master, and say, you know what? This is all I know. I want to stay here. I want to just remain here. It's where I feel safe. It's where I feel comfortable. And even though the legal and moral responsibilities had changed, they continued to actually live in that type of relationship. They were essentially still slaves because even they knew it to be true, they didn't count themselves to have received that. They didn't believe it to be true for themselves. And so they continued to live in that slavery, in that bondage. And the same thing is true about Christianity. We know it to be true, but if we don't count it to be true, if we don't believe it to be true for ourselves, we will continue to live in that slave relationship with sin. And let's face it, it's comfortable there. This is all I've ever known. This is my life. I can't even bear the thought of living apart from that. And so we stay right where we were, where we've always been. Sanctification continues when we believe that we're dead to sin. when we believe that what God said is true, that that slave relationship no longer exists in my life, we can begin continue in the process of sanctification. And now he begins to give the negatives, the do-nots of this sanctification process. And we look at verse 12. He says, "Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires." Sanctification continues when we remind ourselves who the master is. We need to remind ourselves, probably every day, I'm no longer under the authority of sin. I don't have to listen to that. I don't have to do that. I have a choice in the matter. The master says, and you are obligated to do it, right? Master, if you're in a slave relationship, master says, do it, you have to do it. And what he's saying is, you are no longer in that relationship. You do not have to do what you think you have to do. You are free to choose not to sin. There's a quote in Charles Spurgeon that I think is just beautiful. He says this, "Sin shall not have dominion over you. It may assail you and even wound you, but it shall never establish sovereignty over you." And that's on your bulletin too. But what's he saying? You know what? When we are sanctified, when we become like Jesus, it doesn't mean we don't sin anymore. It doesn't mean we are removed from that I'm going to live perfectly. But what it means, in fact, it's still going to inflict pain. It's still going to harm us. It's going to bring difficulty and pain to our life. But what he's saying is, it is no longer in authority. You are no longer obligated to do that. You can choose to do something else. And when we're faced with temptation, that should be one of the first things we think. You know what? I don't have to do this. I am no way obligated to do what has been put before me. I can choose to do something different because I serve a different master now, and that's Christ. Verse 13 then, and we're just going to read the first half of verse 13, and it says this, "Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness." Sanctification continues when we refuse to be used. When we refuse to be used. An interesting description here. He calls a person who sins an instrument of wickedness. Now, isn't that kind of interesting? We think of a person being wicked, but what he's saying is you are an instrument of wickedness. What is an instrument? An instrument's a tool. So what he's saying is, don't be a tool. You know, in our modern vernacular, that's a word we would use. That's a description we would say to somebody who's being used, being taken advantage of. You're a tool. And the truth is, when we as Christians make a choice to sin, we are being a tool. We're being a tool for Satan, really, to be used by him to do his work. And so he's saying, don't allow yourself to be used as an instrument for wicked behavior. Don't allow Satan to take your life, your precious life that you have been given, and be used simply as some tool of his to accomplish horrible things in this world. And I think it's kind of interesting the other word that's used there, and it's the word offer. Don't offer your body. Don't offer yourself to be used as an instrument. We kind of always think when temptation comes in, we're like strong-armed. He's twisting my arm. I got to do this. And yet, in that description, it almost seems, not almost, it is, the fact that he's saying that we offer ourselves for this. And so what is happening when temptation is before us, it has been placed before us, it's like we're going, hey, let me do that for you. Let me offer myself to fulfill that need that you have there. And so there's a conscious decision that's being made. We are consciously deciding at that moment to be used. When we are tempted, he's saying you are making a conscious decision to offer yourself to be used for wickedness. That's, you know, a horrible thought. for us as a Christian, but that's the reality of the description. And saying no, which is what we're talking about here, is not our natural inclination. We still have the old nature, and so the old nature says, say yes, this will be fun, this will be good. And so somehow in this sanctification process, we have to learn to say no, to not offer ourselves up, because naturally that's what I do. I will in my natural self offer myself up to be an instrument of wickedness. And so sanctification helps me to be able to say no, to be able to decline to be a part of that when the offer is put before me. And the truth is that the first time that we face something, if we say yes or if we say no, it is going to make the next yes or the next no more possible and more likely. When we give in to be an instrument of wickedness, the next time that it is put before us, it is more and more likely that we will give in the next time. But when we decline, when we say no, when we refuse to be used as an instrument of wickedness, the next time it is more likely that you're going to be able to decline that offer or decline to make yourself the offer. And so it's the snowball effect. The more times that you say yes, the more likely it is you're going to say yes. The more times you say no, the more likely it is you're going to say no. And so, the rest of that verse, and then into verse 14, he says this: "But rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to Him as an instrument of righteousness, for sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace." You know, it's easy to focus on the negatives, the don't do's. Don't do this, don't do that. That's our natural tendency. We like rules. We like to know the line. Where's the line? I don't want to cross the line. So we set up these rules that we don't approach the line, or that we don't cross the line. And so now he's giving us a positive. It's not only about what you're not going to do, it's about what you are going to do. And that is sanctification continues when we offer ourselves for God's purposes. When it's not just about what I'm not going to do, but it's about what I'm going to do, I'm going to give myself to God. I'm going to surrender to God. I'm going to offer myself for His use instead of the negative of that. You know, when we attempt to battle sin in our own ability, when we just purely do it by building fences, you know what I'm saying? We come up with a set of rules and we live against those set of rules. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to get myself an accountability partner. And I'm not saying that these things are bad. But when that is the emphasis of our defense against sin, all we have done is this. We have created the law again. God gave the law as a demonstration of our sinfulness. And what we have a tendency to do is to build our own law, to give us our own set of rules and say, I'm not going to do that, I'm not going to do that. And we don't have a positive, offensive attack. And yet what he says is this: offer yourselves to God. Surrender. Give yourself to God in defense and as a process of sanctification. Becoming more like Jesus is not just about what you're not doing. It's also about what you're doing. I'm giving myself to God to be used by Him. And there's two steps and it's described here. And the first is that we offer ourselves to God. And that means that we simply surrender, make ourselves available. God, here, do whatever you want with this life. Have at it. And the second one is that a more specific thing, and that is to be an instrument of righteousness. Instrument of wickedness? No. Instrument of righteousness? Yes. And that means that I'm going to offer myself to God to be used for His good, to be used for His glory and His purposes. Remember? Romans chapter 3, there's none righteous. No, not one. So God says, I want you to be my instrument of righteousness. He has the righteousness. I don't. If I want to do acts of righteousness, I have to offer myself as the instrument, and his righteousness will flow through me into the rest of the world. And so, in the same way that Satan wants to use you as an instrument, God wants to use you as an instrument, but not for destruction, not for sin, not for wickedness, but for good and for his glory. And that happens when we surrender ourselves to him. You know, the story of the slaves is really a picture of the church today, I'm afraid. You've been set free. You're no longer obligated to the sin that surrounds you and entices you and pulls you in and attempts to dictate to you what you're going to do. And yet, you have been emancipated. You have been set free. And we need to believe that, and we need to begin living as if that were true. Not as if we're still in bondage, not as if we were still enslaved to those same horrible habits and painful and sinful actions, but to live as if we really were free. That's what God desires for us. When we understand this and we begin to apply these principles, our life changes. We begin to look different. God begins to shape us. He begins to change us and chip away a little bit by a little bit. And we begin to be sanctified. We begin to be changed. We begin to look different, not only to the world, but even to ourselves. As we continue in the next couple of weeks, next few weeks, we're going to be looking more deeply at this. The process of sanctification, the process of becoming more like Jesus. My hope is that would be every one of our heart's desires to be more like Christ. And hopefully, in the coming weeks, we will be able to accomplish that. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for time in your word. And I would pray, God, that these truths would land on our hearts, that they would find good soil, and Lord, they would root. And God, we begin to experience the sanctification, the holiness, the changes, God, that you desire for our life. Change us, Lord. Change us as we sang earlier today from the inside out. We just thank you and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand. Thank you. today as we begin this walk through the idea of being sanctified, the process of sanctification. And it was really four basic points, and I want you guys just to repeat after me. I know that I've been set free.
I know that I've been set free.
I believe that I've been set free.
I believe that I've been set free.
I refuse to be used.
I refuse to be used.
And I offer myself to Christ.
I offer myself to Christ.
That's really the summary of this teaching today. That's the truth that begins the change in our life that will be different than the rest of the world. And my prayer is that we embrace that, we run to that, and we experience that in our life as Christ followers. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you today for our time. I pray, God, that each of us today surrender to you, Lord, that we, if we are still chained, still chained to the sin, Lord, still under the domination of a master that's no longer the master, that God, today you would break that chain. And God, we would begin to experience the freedom that you intend for us. God, that's my prayer for everyone here. Lord, that we will live free from sin and under the only master that matters, and that's Jesus. Thank you today, God. As we go from here, that Lord, you would use us as a light, as a testimony to the world of freedom that comes in Christ. We thank you, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.